So we're talking about not just WordPress today, but websites in general. Mm-hmm. Putting up, for lack of a better term, a faculty web page. That can mean a lot of things, and there can be different approaches. And that's kind of what we're going to talk about today. And this is also distinct from the faculty bio page that exists out there, mm-hmm. which is another course that you teach that talks about how to make changes there. There's probably going to be some changes in that system as we go forward, because that's kind of part of Blackboard and, right. and a service that's out of Blackboard, and Blackboard is going away. So we're working on a new version or a new system to kind of bring all those faculty bios back together.
So would it be possible to import them into Canvas from Blackboard?
Well, see, we don't think it's going to be Canvas that does anything like that at this mm-hmm. point. And so it's probably going to be like a WordPress system or something like that
right.
that will be able to control all those, display them, give faculty control over their over updating their bios.
A little more robust than it is
yeah.
now.
Yeah,
hopefully.
Exactly. Yeah, a little more user friendly, all that kind of stuff. You don't have to log in through Blackboard to get there, but and we also did a workshop earlier called WordPress Best Practices. Mm-hmm. But this is really the kind of the getting started with putting your presence out there. And we'd like to, I do what we like to call digital identities. And so we'll talk a little bit about what the possibilities are of what you would put on a given website.
Okay.
Let me just show you the document that we're working on here. This is kind of what we're going to be talking about. So options for building your academic website. And the reason that I wanted the whiteboard was to talk a little bit about this idea of domains versus subdomains. And again, you may know this stuff, but I like to use this analogy. Hopefully it becomes obvious what this might be. I like to use the house analogy, okay? And if you think of a domain, okay? It's an example of a domain. I have one. Rush.net. Okay, so this is my house. What I have at AndyRush.net are subdomains. So AndyRush.net is the main domain, but I've also got andyblogs.andyrush.net and photos.andyrush.net. Maybe it's photo. I think it's photos. Okay, so if you think of the domain as a house, mm-hmm. andyrush.net, you've got lots of different rooms. Okay, and in some cases you can have even closets inside rooms that can be subdomains or folders at the ends of those kinds of things. So I want to just be able to distinguish between what a domain is and then a subdomain being rooms within that domain.
Okay.
So that's my silly analogy that can go away now and never be spoken of again.
Nothing wrong with it.
but basically what we're talking about is kind of a main identity. And I can bring up what I talked about before, and that is, and actually I shouldn't be doing this, because I thought, yeah. So, bear with me, let me go back and So here's my domain, andyrush.net. And it's just kind of a general idea of what you can do. So I start with my portfolio. One of the advantages of, and Mike's going to talk about some of the other software that's out there, and I'm going to have him kind of go to that next. But so this is andyrush.net, and I've got, you know, an about page that's about me. I've got my resume, or CV is obviously another way to put it. And then the blog links out to us to the subdomain. So you'll notice as I click on the blog link, it will go to that subdomain, andyblogs.andyrush.net. So this is my blog that's there. So you really can kind of create this world of web pages that do everything that you want to do. And in some cases, you'll have different capabilities depending on what system you use. Mm-hmm. So anyway, that's kind of the introduction to that. And I also want to we've got some examples. We're going to talk a little bit about WordPress and also something called Weebly. But there's many other services out there. There's Squarespace, there's Wix, and hundreds of other ones. And there's other open source software that you can install as well. One of the other things that we want to just bear in mind as we start working with these websites is, and I'm going to try to resize this if I can. Let's go into the middle. One of the things we want to try to emphasize is the idea of going mobile. And as we shrink down the size of this window, you should start to see some of the changes that happen. Mm-hmm. And notice that as we get to something that looks a lot like this, you can imagine this being displayed on a phone, you know, a smartphone, or as you get bigger on a tablet. But you'll notice that the interface at the top kind of changed around. And there's a basic search button, and then a basic button here that is the menu, right? So that stuff that will eventually get exposed as you start pulling this out this way, changes. You know, this is maybe the iPad version here, and then this is the smartphone version.
The good part is all of this is being built in the background while you're building.
Exactly. So one of the things that
worry about it.
What WordPress calls these things are responsive web design, responsive websites, mm-hmm. and it's just that it responds to the type of device that you're using, and we believe will do it in just a slightly different way.
My current WordPress doesn't do that.
it's theme dependent, mm-hmm. so themes will do a better some will do a better job than others, but
yeah.
Basically what WordPress categorizes some of those themes that you'll use. Are responsive design.
Right.
If you use a responsive website, then you'll get this kind of option.
Yeah. My problem is I paid to have it professionally redone in August and still working on it.
Okay.
Luckily, he's the husband of one of my friends, so you know he can't exactly escape. So
there you go.
Right.
So that's kind of the initial you know, what we're going to talk about. And we've got some examples here, and I think Mike's got a sheet of examples. You can click on some of those ones that we talked about I've got here.
Okay.
Some of the ones, if you do it.
If you want to show more.
But I'll get into the WordPress interface in just a second. But that's kind of what we're talking about. And then the other things are so we talk about theming. Okay. Use a theme to make it look the way that you want to. Some themes will function differently than others and offer different functionality. And then there's plugins which allow you even more capability. Things like giving you a contact form or an events calendar or other plugins in that set, or even security plugins. Those get to be important as your website becomes popular. And so that allows you to kind of get creative, choosing a theme that you like and kind of massaging it into something that you like. Same thing with Weebly. It's a time where you can kind of get creative and make it look like something other than what Blackboard looks like. To blog or not to blog, that is something that both Weebly and WordPress offer, but WordPress is by far the more popular platform to blog on. It's really made for it.
It was started as a blog.
Yeah, exactly. And so that adds some dynamism to your website. If you want just static pages where you have your CV and you have a syllabus or a course page, You don't need to think about that. And you may want to go with something more simplified or more straightforward in the sense of what how Weebly does things. Okay.
Some people just want a site to place things and have them out
exactly.
there. Some want a site to participate with a lot, put things up currently.
Now you'll notice what happens in this particular site where I say here to sidebar or not to sidebar, that there can be additional content on the sides.
Mm-hmm.
And so this is just again a function of the theme, and each one of these pieces, the search area, the links area, the recent post area, those are all in WordPress what are called widgets. So that's a design element you can choose to use or not. Otherwise you can just kind of do full page. Full page pages or posts. The elements that you may want to put into your page, your website, things like galleries, photo galleries, and in some cases, some of the gallery plugins allow you to do video as well. So if you want to feature your videos, they can be Vimeo, YouTube, and other ones will easily kind of fit into those areas. Obviously, blogging is one of the things that you can have as an element. Again, keeping your students up to date, keeping your colleagues up to date in terms of what you're working on. A CV page, a course page, any publications that you finished or are working on. Okay. And in terms of WordPress, the functionality of your site is going to be somewhat limited. We talk about WordPress.com, mm-hmm. which is the more kind of Weebly-like setup where you go to WordPress.com and you sign up for a blog and then you get whatever your name.wordpress.com. So again, WordPress.com is the main domain, and then you get a subdomain on WordPress's site. As opposed to hosted WordPress, which is where you go to a hosting company, and we have recommendations, and we're hopefully actually going to be getting a system here at UNF where faculty can sign up and either bring their domain or get a free domain to use and build out your faculty site. So we're not ready to announce anything, but we're making progress. We're at the VP level of acceptance, so that's a good sign. But hosted WordPress is an option where you really can control not only your identity and your data that's there, all the stuff that is incorporated into your site, but you'll be able to put in all the plugins that you want. You'll really be able to customize it much further than you would with a standard WordPress.com hosted site.
Doesn't WordPress also, because I think that's what my site currently is in, I think they also have their own hosting service. It's kind of bare bones, but it gets the job done.
So they have recommended sites.
Mm-hmm.
WordPress.com is actually what they call multi-site.
Right.
That's an implementation of multi-site. So you go to one place, you sign up, you give them your email address, and then you get a little small sliver on that space.
Mm-hmm.
Hosted means you pick wherever you want this installation to be.
Right.
WordPress will recommend some hosts,
mm-hmm.
But really anybody who's out there will host WordPress for the most part. It's WordPress is 25% of the web. You know, not just like, you know, systems, but a given web page there's a 1 in 4 chance that it's probably going to be WordPress.
That's amazing.
It is amazing. It's
yeah.
had incredible growth. The downside to that can be things like security issues.
Right.
So you want to make sure that your site is got proper authentication systems and then stuff in the background to take out comment spam and all that kind of stuff.
Right.
So that's an issue if you decide to kind of allow comments and that sort of thing. So we can talk a little bit about that too. But hosted WordPress, bottom line, you get a lot of kind of flexibility in terms of what you want to do with your site. And you can trick it out to make it look like all kinds of different things. You can build all kinds of neat stuff with the plugins and the themes that are available. So that's kind of a preview of what's there. I'll talk more about WordPress, but I want to let Mike talk a little bit about where Weebly fits into this, and then we'll kind of tie things up with questions at the end.
So you want me to show the sites you had up, or just go through how Weebly works?
Yeah, go through how Weebly works. Yep.
Sorry about that. Oh, samples.
Yeah, if you want to go back to example websites, by all means.
Okay.
I'm getting dry mouth. I'm going to go quickly grab my drink. I'll be right back.
I might show one real quick, just to show how we got started.
And by the way, Monica, we'll share this. If you didn't see it already, we'll share this website with you, which has the resources that we're looking at right now. It's a real simple URL to get there.
Now, Andy mentioned that these are like domain names. We believe it's more like you build an account and build it. So you could have your domain name would be monica.weebly.com. Mm-hmm. And this is a free service. That's the good part of this. So, I just helped somebody start this one the other day. Maybe really slow when I log in. I hope this doesn't do this.
There it is.
He came in Tuesday to make a change on his old website. He came in Monday. We had trouble making it. It was through Dreamweaver. Came back Tuesday. I said, let's move you away from this. And we, in about an hour, built this. So because we had the old things to pull from and put in. He's not finished. It's just a beginning. But just to give you an idea, CV, we just put it here and then uploaded a PDF. So that way, if he puts the PDF somewhere else, it's just updated.
It's a pretty universal format, too.
Yeah. Courses, we just started building a template where he could add his courses. Like, I'm showing it because it's really kind of quick.
Cool. Yeah, they must be having some issues up their site.
He has a ton of YouTube videos out on YouTube already, so I showed him how to put them in. That's just an idea. Here's my Weebly page. I help people with multiple sites. You could add me as an administrator, so I could help you add or change or do things if you want, or add a banner, that kind of thing. Or if you're having trouble, I had a professor who was in Japan for a year, spent sabbatical, and he'd email me, can you fix this? I can't get it to work. Okay, hold on. Here. So I'm good. I have a lot of other sites. We can show you more in a minute. I'm going to show you how easy it is to set up and build a site. So I'm going to add a site, another one, real quick. And we're going to call it a site and not a blog or a store. Okay. I can add a blog in the site, a blog page, easily. So I'm going to pick a theme, just to start fast. I always like this one, or I've used a couple others, but I'm going to pick this plain lines, because it's just real straightforward, and it's easy to change around a lot. And it's going to want a domain name, but I'm going to skip that for now. We're not going to publish. Well, let me go over this. You can use the free domain and put monica.weebly.com. It's probably going to show you it's been taken. So if I put.
Now, Monica DePaul might likely not be available.
Timeand.com. Time and watches.
Yeah.
It's available.
No, I do already own mpdepaul.com.
Then you would use this one.
Yeah.
So I'm just going to say. So here's my site. I don't always like these responsive banners because they pop out some things you might want sometimes. They can be frustrating. They can be nice too. A lot of people want to, I had some history professor who wanted to put a map of a certain area, St. Augustine, in there. So if your window wasn't big enough, St. Augustine didn't show.
Oh, yeah.
So we did it anyway. So I'm going to come down here. You can choose tall, short, no header, landing page, which really gives you a copy up here, or splash page. I'm just going to say no header. I could start dragging elements from here to build with, or I can select choose a layout, which is really kind of nice. Did a lot of the groundwork for you, so that one's kind of nice. Just pops everything in to start with. Nice placeholders to put your copy. You can build this by hand easily, too. So I'm going to say keep that. Next thing I'll do real quick. Well, before we do this, let me go over the top. Here's your build section with all your tools where you do most of the work. In your menu will show the pages up here. You can click on pages. Here's three. They're easy to add. What I like to do is build out the home page, get everything in, even a copyright at the bottom or something. Then I like to duplicate that for the contact page and edit it. Then you don't have to build everything every time. WordPress is probably different with templates. And this, you can't really create templates to do. You know, so I just kind of build a template first. You can add a page and not have it show in the menu. So if you wanted to just have a link to something that you don't want in the menu, I'll show you that in a minute. Theme is where you would change the theme if you didn't like this one. Or go in and edit code or change the fonts. I pretty much leave this alone as much as possible because mm-hmm. the themes are designed nicely by designers.
Right.
Or I recommend that to a lot of people that don't know how to change it too much. It does change the feel. So, store, unless you're selling something, I'm not going to go there, and I'll keep it quick. Settings. This is where you change this to instead of where it said my site at the top, this is where I'll change this. Mm-hmm. It hits, you have to make sure you click save everywhere. Simple save. Have a password protected site. I come down here if you want to publish your site, see what it looks like, and then unpublish, you would do that right here. The next thing I recommend and use a lot is description of the site and then your keywords that help with Google search and Yahoo search. And if you do happen to use a Google Analytics to track things on your site, you would just create an account, get the code there, and just put it in a box here and hit save, and it's done. Mm-hmm. It's that easy. So, editors, if you wanted someone else to edit your site, you could add one, just send them an email and they become your editor to help you. So, that's where you would add me if you wanted to. Or Andy. And I'm not going to go over this other stuff too much. Blog is about blog settings, what you can turn on and off. I won't go over that right now, but here's where you would edit that. I'm going to go back to build. And then we've got our text box here, so I'm going to pull in an image at the top. So I'm going to put it, see that blue bar tells you where you're putting something. It could be between. I'm going to put it way across the top. And on it, and it's going to want me to drag or drop something. So I'm going to drag this here, and it's done.
And you added text there.
I added text in the image.
Right.
Okay. I'm going to, I could come down here. This footer stays there with a Weebly logo. I've learned how to deleted some in the code sometimes on some templates, or you can paint or delete it. But I have kind of easy to get rid of sometimes. You could take a little divider line down here, put it under here, and now I could come and put like maybe a text box under that. Write copyright. It. Might want a spacer here. So these are nice little side things to work with. This little spacer is nice. Put it in here. It adds some space. And that's too much. Or too little. If you can't get rid of the logo at the bottom, I put a spacer in and drag it really far down, and then it goes up the page. It works. Or I can shorten it. So that's good. So that simple. Come to pages. I'm going to look at this. I'm going to say copy. It shows up at the bottom as a duplicate. So I'm going to take it now and change the name right here. It's easy to call this gallery. And just back up. It's saved. Now I have gallery at the top menu up here on the right. All I have to do now is take this and put it where I want. It's on the far right. I like to keep contact on the far right, like most people do. So I just pull it up and see how it tucked in. Suddenly it became a sub page under home. I don't want that, so you pull it back out. Easy to do sub menus. So now I want to go edit.
In your menu at the top, can you make one of those? Can you just put text in and make it a link to a page at another website?
I don't know.
Okay.
I've been wondering that. I was wondering if you showed something. Okay. You can hide it in the menu bar in the navigation right here.
I think that would be if you linked to it from another source but didn't want it selectable.
You don't want it always in your menu bar. I can show you a site where I've done 12 gallery pages, but I didn't want all the galleries in the menu bar. So anyway.
It doesn't seem like you can do it.
I don't think you can, but that is fine. The CV thing. I would just made a CV page, but then I had to click here for CV.
Yeah, like for my site, I've got the blog on another. It's a subdomain, but it's still another website. I want to get a link to that.
Now I'm going to build the gallery page. I'm just going to delete. Easy. So now I'm going to add a gallery. I'm going to just put it over here. Let's say, click upload images. All 9 of these and drag them over. Builds a gallery for you all at once. It's super easy. And then it even builds a slideshow while it's doing this. It looks heavy here to me, so I can say, well, let me move this photo right here over to the side. Like, much like Facebook galleries, just dragging photos around to where you get them. You can put captions under them. I change the columns if I want this to be 3 or less. This just makes it larger, smaller. It's pretty simple to play with. Same with that adding text box, a headline box, title box, or text box, image galleries. You can do a slideshow, which automatically plays, not quite like the gallery. Contact forms are easy. Adding a map is easy. You just drag the tool over, type in the city, and it pops up with a map.
Is it a Google map? And the one that you built for El Shafti?
Is that his name? El Shafti.
Shafti. I think that's, if you use that, then that's a Google map.
I don't want to go into doing, training for this. I mean, I'll be glad to help anytime. So do you have any questions? I just would like to show how simple it is.
Yeah, I mean, it's very simple. It seems very straightforward. I wasn't even aware of Weebly. I mean, I've done some of my own designs on WordPress, and it's pretty easy there. It's not that easy.
Yeah, this is more we'll see. Right in front of you. What you see is what you get. It's just like right there. It's not go into this column, picking this, and you don't see it until it's all done.
Yeah, I wish many of the elements that are available in Weebly were kind of natively available in WordPress. You can get the drag and drop kind of nature of you know what Weebly does in a WordPress installation, but it's a little bit convoluted.
Most of these are available. There's a few with these little lightning bolts that are you have to upgrade to get, like a search engine. There's a search box. I've built a lot of sites without needing any of those. More happy. Most faculty don't need search things. Oh, let's add a page. Instead of duplicating, I'm going to click add a page, and we're going to add a blog page.
When I brought up PhD video, is that like hosting it on the site, or can you still? You don't have to page it embed YouTube, do you?
No, you can drag that over and embed YouTube, or the code for something like Vimeo or SoundCloud. You can put code in.
Okay.
When I click on the X there, I saw something that I think answered our question from before.
So I just added a blog page. Easy. You know, you click post. You just click new post. You can add author archives. I'll show you our Spain trip where we had students blogging. I'll let's have this, but it also pops up at the menu under blog.
It's a blog within a website, which is kind of nice. Andy was saying his took his out of the site where you have your other one, but if you're starting from scratch,
I'll let's out. We're not going to save this anyway.
So it's saving in the background while we're working.
So click on the plus to add a page. One of the choices is external page.
Oh, yeah.
So you can
type in a link to your blog here. Name it blog. Got it. Thank you. Just noticing that. Yeah, if I want to add something here, let's say this word means I want a resume, add a file. Or I add an internal page from here, or I add an outside website from here, or I make it an email address.
Opens up an email account.
Yeah.
So there's all your options for links, internal, external.
But the others I use a lot, but the files could be Word document, PDF, anything like that. Or a ShareStream, we just post the link. Save or. And I'm back right here.
Before you leave that, I have one more question in terms of capability. You've got a page that you built that has a home page, and then you decide, oh, I don't want that to be the first page that they look at when they get to a site. Can you change what the home page is?
Sure. I could move it here, make about.
So it's whatever is the first
about home. I could change the name if I don't want to call it home.
Oh, so there's about. The top. Okay.
Yeah, it's right. Not like the typical homepage where that's the header you're in.
But so when you go to whatever.weebly.com, the about page now will be what's displayed first. Okay.
Sure.
Right.
Yeah. Oh, I don't want to do that. I have to make it.
Yeah.
Take one time. I don't want to take one for somebody that might want it.
Gotcha. Okay. All right. No, I was just curious how.
Let me back out of here and show you. I showed you all the sites. I'm not going to go into them. But that's just, you can have multiple sites,
and it doesn't matter. So
they're all different domains. Some of them have. Some of them do have their domains. Here's one we did with Gonzalo Lopez, a professor here. And some of her publications. A lot of her research is in Colombia. Done a lot of photo galleries from graffiti projects that help keep kids from joining gangs and cartels. Teaching, she's added galleries with her
also see Connor's project, the library. We had a gallery each thing, interviews, pages. Person has an interview. A poster, which is open interview. Listen, it's a share stream. We uploaded it here on the UNF server and then just added the sound file. You can't add sound files to Weebly. You can house them somewhere else. You can still get them.
I can bring it. I can open it up again. All right. Yes,
I'll let you do it. We don't have to go through all those. Yeah. I was going to show the Convena and how I did 12 galleries, but that's all right. She probably doesn't want 12 galleries.
Well, she may, and she'll want a more help from us. Right. No, I can get back to that page, and I'm still logged in. So what we're also trying to demonstrate is it depends on where you want to go, which of these systems you're going to use.
Right.
Because Weebly's going to be good for some things, but there may be more kind of interaction with other websites. One of the things that WordPress allows you to do is it generates by default an RSS feed, which basically is a feed of all the posts that are in a given website. And then those can be then syndicated out to another site. So one of the ways that it can function, and this is a typical example, is that a faculty member will have their own site or a site that acts as what we call the mother blog, right? And students will then post their reflections, whatever, and that stuff can be syndicated into the mother blog. So that the whole course all the course content can be displayed in that main blog from all the students. The students don't have to worry about, you know, they can write on their own blog. They don't have to worry about being then a member of the main blog. That stuff just can happen in the background automatically. So one of the things that's built into WordPress by default is this RSS, and that allows a lot of possibilities in terms of sending that information out. RSS is also available. Go ahead.
What does RSS mean?
It either stands for really simple syndication, and I can't remember all the other choices.
That's all right. That's kind of one.
That's one of those. Yeah. One of those.
I've heard the really simple syndication thing. I wasn't aware of any others. Actually,
and maybe I'm even like.
I knew what
buying
I
those
was
too, but it's essentially it's almost like a publish and then push kind of idea. The other place where RSS might come in, and again, WordPress has the advantage of doing this. You mentioned the thing with sounds. If you wanted to do a podcast site where you wanted to have and what I call subscription audio, students walk around with their Android devices, their iPhones, whatever, and they've got essentially pod catchers like iTunes or whatever's on Android. There's lots of them out there, and you don't have to use iTunes on iOS devices either. But you could do a periodic audio update of whatever you're doing. Do a podcast, a weekly, a monthly, a daily, whatever. And the advantage that WordPress would have is when you publish that audio file, it's part of the RSS that's there. That can be that feed that you put into iTunes. So they've got that kind of instant podcast ability that is there. Now, there are plugins for podcasting that make it even easier, that really give you some of the hooks into iTunes that allow you to get into the iTunes ecosystem and that kind of thing. But WordPress would be the place where you could kind of host the show notes of a podcast and more information, the links that you talk about in a podcast. That can be, you know, in most cases, almost built automatically without thinking about it. So it does a really good job with that kind of stuff. So the example in terms of WordPress, or examples in terms of WordPress, this is a WordPress.com site. It's andyrushunf.wordpress.com. So again, This is using WordPress.com as the host, and I would log into this separately. You know, I'd go to WordPress.com and log in there separately to get to the admin of this area. But again, I've built an about page, a CV page. There's a link out to the UNF webpage.
So you put your CV on the page.
Have you noticed over your time that many professors do that or prefer OTDM?
It really depends. One of the things about having a CV or a resume page here in line is that you can put those links very easily into the document. You can make changes more readily. If you make changes in a PDF, you've got to make the change, upload it again. Mm-hmm. If you make it kind of in this interface, you can easily go back and make the.
So if somebody has your CV, you just email them.
Exactly. Now there is, I think, let's go back to the. This is a nice little discovery that I made. So there's, let me go to the DIY website post. There's a plugin that I added that is a print button. So instead of all this other junk that's out around the outside and the footer and that kind of thing, if you install this print plugin, if you click on this, it will just print the page itself. Now it does have this this kind of standard web information here and at the top, but this is just the content of the page or the blog post. It's not all the headers and the sidebars and that kind of stuff. Where you would get if you just printed that page within the browser infrastructure.
Can you turn? I think you can turn off the photos, but it's not printing photos that you use Ink for some people.
I don't know. Simplified.
That's all right. Don't worry.
Headers and footers.
There you go.
And that's a function of the Google web browser.
Right.
That is nice.
But if you want to, this is wordpressdemo.certunf.org. And then there's more information here about WordPress and kind of what we're doing at this particular website. But DIY Academic Websites is one of the posts within this. So if you go to the homepage, so wordpressdemo.certunf.org, and just scroll down. I keep this featured page, Welcome to CERT WordPress, to kind of say what this is. But under recent posts, it's DIY Academic Websites. And that's where you'll get that resource page. Okay. So there's WordPress.com, which again, my Andy Rush UNF.WordPress. And you probably know this already, but if you go to WordPress.com, it immediately says, oh, you want a website, sign up for that.
That's not WordPress.
And I spelled it wrong, I bet you, so that's why. WordPress.com. Did I get it right this time? Hopefully. It's just as simple as clicking on create a website, and just like at Weebly, it'll ask you what your site is about, and then it'll ask you, you know, what domain you want to use. Let's say I want to do an arts and entertainment site about movies. I can go and I can pick, and this is the one that I use for my site, and enter a domain or keyword. You can, this looks like it's gone up, starting at $18 a year, you can get your...
That's why I didn't even...
Oh, it's mapping it. That's right. I don't know, are you familiar with the term of mapping domains? Does that ring a bell with you?
No,
I can explain
actually.
It. So basically... You purchased a domain, and I think you mentioned it a second ago.
Well, yeah, I actually got it through WordPress, so I think I did the lower option right there.
Okay, so let's say you went through and domain providers, domain registrars is the term. I can go get andyrush.com if it's available at any registrar.
Right.
GoDaddy is a famous one. Who I don't recommend that you do, but they're the most famous. I use a site called Hover, hover.com, but you can go and see domains that are available.
Right.
And if you purchase them outside of some of these systems, you can get them sometimes cheaper than what you would pay through a WordPress.com or through a Weebly or a Wix or whatever. And then it's not they you go through, you're kind of eliminating the middleman. You're going directly to the registrar to get your domain. You can, once you own it that way, you can do what's called a mapping of a domain. And this comes into play on WordPress.com, where you pay $13 a year to map andyrushunf.wordpress.com, change that to andyrush.com. You map it on top of that.
Right.
That's map really has to do with the pathways to get there and through a system called DNS. But anyway, you can do the same thing if you self-host your WordPress, though. So if you've got a hosting provider that does WordPress, you can, through the hosting provider, say, map this domain to my system, and then you can have that as your top-level domain, and then you can create those subdomains through that. So that's the idea behind mapping a domain, right? I'm not going to go through the rest of this. You can, you know, you can sign up for a WordPress.com site, and you might say, "Well, I don't really need WordPress.com at all because I'm not going to host my sites through there." I would argue, though, it's still good to go through WordPress.com because they do provide a lot of, and just with the free service, they do provide a lot of functionality by having. You know, by having a registered site at WordPress.com, you can, for instance, if you had multiple WordPress.com sites, you can manage all those sites through one interface. You don't have to log into each site to get to each of those sites. If you have hosted WordPress sites, you can add those into your WordPress.com list so that doesn't matter, WordPress.com or hosted, you can get to all those admin interfaces through one interface, through one login, right? They have spam protection for free. It's called Akismet. Okay, so it's basically a plugin that gets installed on WordPress. It's built into WordPress.com, but if you have a hosted version, Akismet is a plugin that you get installed, and you just need to supply what's called a key so that it's unique to your site. That way, otherwise, it's a commercial use of that software, and you have to pay for it. But to get it free, and spam protection becomes obvious, you know, weeks or maybe a month after you get your site, where people are commenting on your site. You've got places where things are coming in, and it's, you know, all kinds of advertisements and things like that.
Well, like what happens on Facebook. Raymond sunglasses.
Yeah, exactly. As long as there's a form that the web bots can find, that goes into and will be added to. Now, it won't necessarily be published on your site, but it'll keep coming in, and you have to approve it or disapprove it. And if you're having students, especially, or people that are commenting on your blog posts and websites, you want to be able to get rid of that stuff. So Akismet is a good spam protection.
How do you spell it?
It's A-K-I-S-M-E-T.
I-S-M-E-T.
Like Kismet with Akismet.
Akismet.
Another plugin that, and this is what allows you to manage all those sites, there's a plugin called Jetpack.
A plugin called what?
Called Jetpack. And Jetpack allows, what it will do is it'll plug into that WordPress.com account that you have, and it'll say, "Hey, I'm one of your WordPress sites." And all the sites that you install Jetpack on, it'll say, "Hey, I'm one of your WordPress sites." So all that stuff will be part of that. But Jetpack does a whole lot more. It has contact forms and other, it'll allow you to keep all your plugins up to date. So it will go ahead and make those updates without, you know, you having to go and manually do it. So Jetpack is really kind of a cool, just like it says, it's a backpack, it's a jetpack full of cool stuff, all right? So I highly recommend, you know, that as you go forward with it. So those are kind of the benefits of having a WordPress.com, whether you're going to use it or not. And what you can do is on the main page of your WordPress.com site, say, you can say, link to my, you know, make a link to your main site or something like that, so that it at least has that use as well.
Right.
People might discover you through the WordPress.com site, but your other stuff is hosted.
The more you link to back and forth, if you link your faculty bio to your website and back, the farther up you're going to move in Google. What do you think your needs would be for websites for yourself and your students, or your students?
Well, I haven't really thought about a whole lot of how I would use websites in such a manner. Of course, I mean, outside of teaching and like a place to host blogs and various writing that I do and to sell books, which I'm already trying to do, but it hasn't worked very well. So, you know, trying to work on.
Which this would help
yeah.
with getting it out there more.
Oh, yeah. Yeah. And the blog idea sounds like what you're saying with students can put it in their own blogs and links to a mother blog. That sounds like it could be useful in terms of aggregating things
yeah.
perhaps more effectively than the Blackboard discussion board would.
Right, right. It's what we've discovered that it does is it allows students to kind of own their space
mm-hmm.
and be in that comfortable environment where they can control how it looks and feels.
Right.
And then that can become, you know, their posts and the way that this works essentially is, let's say they're writing all their writings about stuff and it's personal stuff, but then there's a post that they want to share with the class and share
right.
it onto the mother blog. They tag it or categorize it in a certain way, and that's one of the functionalities of WordPress.
Mm-hmm.
So they categorize it with, you know, whatever, maybe what the course name is or something along that line.
Mm-hmm.
And then that gets almost like a little radar signal that gets sent out to the mother blog, and the mother blog recognizes that registered site as a post that needs to get pulled in.
Mm-hmm.
It won't pull in all the students' personal stuff.
Right.
Just that particular post.
And if the student doesn't mind, it could be linked to the personal stuff, couldn't it?
Sure.
Yeah.
Sure. Yep. Yeah. And that's, you know, that's a, and that's the kind of the beauty of it is that they kind of protect their privacy, quote unquote, with some of that stuff. They control what gets published out and kind of, now that doesn't mean that they're not going to get their site discovered and
right.
you know, but they can also privatize posts. They can hide things behind, logins or just keep it completely hidden from the public if they want to as well. But you're going
to. I was just going to show more how we used the Spain. I went to Spain last summer with a history class and anthropology class. We created a site and blog and to house videos, YouTube videos, gallery. I had mentioned this is how I did 12 galleries. I did all these pages and hid them.
Mm-hmm.
But we had the students blogging. I ended up doing most of it because they were having trouble with Wi-Fi. So it shows you the blogs. They were writing in groups and blogging, so I broke up all of this as to how it worked.
Mm-hmm.
I forget what they call it. Like tagging, so you can search by subject or group or name, whatever. You just kind of put that at the end of the story, hidden in the background. But just to give you an idea, and it allowed all of them to be administrators so they could access it.
Mm-hmm.
That worked really well. And then when we finally finished publishing the book, we put the publisher here where you could order or allow download, view, order their print on demand. That was
just one way of using it for a course. And that was a big course. A travel abroad 3-week course. So that was...
Now, it sounds like you have experience with using WordPress. So I don't know if I really need
yes.
to get into...
Yeah, I mean, I've used it a bit. I don't consider myself a master at it, though.
Okay. I mean, the purpose of this particular workshop isn't necessarily to get into the details of
right.
of how to use WordPress, other than, you know, we can talk a little bit about, you know, the basic components. You've got posts, blog posts, where you can add new ones, you can
mm-hmm.
categorize them and so forth. You've got pages, which are really more static documents.
Right.
You've got the appearance area where you can go in and you can change the themes and change the widgets and that kind of thing. And you've got plugins, which add further functionality to your site. And,
mm-hmm.
and there's thousands of plugins that are out there that allow you to do lots of different things.
I know I've used posts, pages, and plugins before.
Okay.
I don't remember events being there.
No, you wouldn't, because that is a plugin. It's called, I think it's called the events calendar. So if I go here, I can control what events get shown, and I can view this on the events page. So that things will appear like this. And so you can have a little button, it has a little built-in button that allows you to add it to a Google Calendar
or to an iCal, you can go to the website of the event, that kind of thing. And if I want to view all the events, I go back to the events page, and it shows, you know, there's nothing coming up because this, you know, I've been adding to this. It's just more of a demo page. But there is at unfdhi.org, there's an events using the same events plugin. This is how they'll look as they're displayed here. There's all these workshops coming up in April. You can, you know, find events. You can also change the view if you want to see what a monthly view looks like, that kind of thing. So it's a nice little free plugin that, that can be added to your blog. Here's that Jetpack plugin. And if you go to that page, you'll see just kind of the different capabilities that it has. And you can turn them, you turn things on and turn them off. And some of them are self-explanatory. You can actually, you know, some of these are paid add-ons that you need to, you know, to pay for.
So Jetpack is otherwise free then?
Most of the capability of Jetpack is free, yeah.
The plugin's free, is what she was asking.
The plugin is free. Yeah.
I think
you go to the plugins page or when you click add new, you search for Jetpack and it adds that in. And then there's some information that you provide through your WordPress.com account that allows you to kind of tie all that stuff together. Okay. So again, we've got about just a couple more minutes left. But what I do want to kind of finish up with is, again, it's whichever approach kind of that you want to take.
Right.
If you want to do more of the kind of the dynamic sites, the communication sites, WordPress is probably where you want to go. Mm-hmm. If you've got just a few pages that you want to put up and you want to build things quickly and easily, you know, Weebly might be the way to go. The advantage of WordPress, and it's a disadvantage that it doesn't have that, you know, you don't build the content at the same time that you build the site.
Right.
WordPress separates the content and separates the design and then pulls them together in a database, basically. You know, Weebly, what you do is you go and you create those little sections with text and images. Mm-hmm. You do that on the fly and it's drag and drop. So that makes that easier.
Yeah.
But the management, some of that stuff in the background is a little more difficult, and then vice versa for WordPress.
And it's a little limited. But
it's
a little, for a limited free service, it's pretty nice.
The thing that I think we're going to try to get faculty at UNF especially to do is realize that you want to get your stuff off of WordPress.com. You want to get your stuff off of Weebly.com. You want to own your space and control that data that you have, and then data migration becomes easier, you know. So say in 5 years there's a brand new system and WordPress is no longer, you know, viable, and there's a new system that you want to use, there would be a migration path, you know, to take all your data from your website and move it there, and you would own it. You wouldn't have to go ask permission at WordPress.com or Weebly.com, hey, can I have my data please? It's, you know, you host it someplace. And
how
you
do you
ownership.
Host it someplace though, like you were talking about?
Mm-hmm.
Like, what is the difference between having WordPress hosted and, okay, so when you say you own the hosting.
Huh. All right, so you don't own the servers that the hosts host on. It's not like you're hosting this in your basement. You have a computer that's running in your basement with an internet connection kind of thing. Some people can and do that. But no, you're paying a host to host your stuff. But and there's a couple of places that we can recommend that do a pretty good job at really allowing you the freedom to do what you want, and you own your data as long as you're hosting at those particular sites. So DreamHost is one. There's I'm blanking on it right now, and I probably should have just a list of places. There's actually a company that got started in the previous university that I was at. The guys that I work with broke off from the university and decided to start their own hosting company, Reclaim Hosting. So, and their advantage is that they're thinking about this from an academic perspective.
So they work with, you know, places like Stanford and Oklahoma University and Brigham Young University and different universities to kind of develop systems for faculty and students to publish with this kind of emphasis on identity and owning their data. And then when students graduate, there's an easy method to take all their stuff off of the site and then export it to, you know, another hosting provider that they decide to go with. Or they get a more standard hosting account through Reclaim or through Dreamhost or Gatorhost or whatever they're using. Gatorhost was one of the ones that I was trying to think of. So that's the advantage of kind of hosting, you know, doing it, and that's why we kind of call it do it yourself.
Right.
Is that you kind of start with these Weebly and WordPress systems that they host, and then what you can do if you've got a WordPress.com site is just do a simple export and take that WordPress.com blog installation and put it on a self-hosted. And all that data translates very seamlessly and easily into a full-blown hosted site that you then control. Okay. With control comes responsibility. And so you need to keep, you know, WordPress.com will keep up to date any security and, you know, problems and that kind of thing. You've got to do that on your hosted site if you're going to decide to host it. So you need to keep up with making sure that your themes and your plugins and the WordPress installation itself is up to date, because that's where security problems happen is that they discover ways that people can get into sites. You know, patching those holes is all about, you know, updating that software and keeping that stuff up to date.
Now, when you want to log in to edit the site, do you still go to WordPress to do that?
So when I talked about the Jetpack thing, if you want to, again, you can go to your WordPress.com site, mm-hmm. and then from there, you can manage your other sites.
Oh, okay.
So you would say, okay, I'm managing andyrushunf.wordpress.com now. Now I click on the button that says switch sites, and then I go to andyrush.net and edit that site. And then I go to andyblogs.andyrush.net and edit that site, all through one interface.
Okay.
And when you log into a site, when you see the administrative login for a particular site, and I'll show you that. I think it'll be available here. See where it says login with WordPress.com?
Mm-hmm.
That is an indication that this particular site has been, through Jetpack, registered as one of the sites that you can control. So
okay.
As long as you're logged into WordPress.com, you click on this button, it'll use your credentials and you'll be able to get into it. So it's a nice way to kind of consolidate all those crazy logins that you might have.
Mm-hmm.
So it does turn out to be a nice system if you're managing multiple websites.
Okay. All right.
And that brings us to 3:00. And all our time has been taken up.
Mm-hmm.